The question I probably get asked most frequently as a sports scientist is, what metrics should I use, especially when it comes to force plate testing? And the goal for this video today then is to share and talk through this framework for countermovement jump metric analysis. And I've also shared this framework in a written blog post in which you can dive even deeper into both the metrics and some of the references and studies that underpin them. I'll certainly put a link below to that post that's on my Global Performance Insights blog. Now, there's lots of different metrics that we could use, and different people advocate for different metrics. There's not necessarily a single right way of doing it, but you need to try to combine that scientific underpinning and reasoning to the metrics, as well as the practical application that you are going to use it for in your setting. Now, though, let me give you a sneak peek of my final framework and what we're going to build up to in this video. So this is my current framework. And of course, like anything in science where our knowledge evolves, I definitely maintain the desire and ability to adapt and evolve this over time. You'll see straight away that it's broken into these three buckets of outcome, strategy, and asymmetry, which we're going to talk a little bit more about. And also we have these foundational metrics alongside some more exploratory metrics. And that's based on this 80-20 rule, that rule of thumb that really 80% of the time, let's focus on really foundational approaches. In this case, well-studied metrics that we're pretty confident in, that have been analyzed for their reliability and their relevance. But then we're going to also sprinkle in some more innovative metrics that we're just not yet confident enough to hang our hat on, but they're part of our exploration. Given the countermovement jump is probably the most common jump in applied practice today, that's why I've chosen it for this topic on picking metrics. And I think most commonly, a countermovement jump assessment is used for three key purposes. We use it for profiling, trying to establish the physical capacities of our athletes. We use it for a more fatigue-based ongoing monitoring perspective to try and analyze the load-response relationship in our athletes. And then we're also using it in rehab, when the focus may be more so in how they're moving and in particular on any asymmetries. Here we have a table that was developed by Ryan McLaughlin at VALD illustrating this and the three different purposes and really the corresponding questions that each of these buckets are trying to answer. And let's talk firstly then about physical profiling, where we're trying to understand what is the outcome in terms of their physical capacities as assessed through a countermovement jump. Jump outcome measures are most commonly things like jump height, peak power, perhaps absolute or relative to body weight. We might also look at peak force, again, absolute or potentially relative to body weight, and perhaps impulse as well, which, as I've spoken about previously in this series, is this interaction between the force an individual applies over time. And we can think of it as the area under the force time curve. But with all these kind of outcome measures, a lot of them frequently are highly correlated. One study, for instance, has shown that the primary determinant of jump height is relative net vertical impulse. And therefore, we might not necessarily want to measure both of those measures, both that net vertical impulse and the jump height, particularly if we're using the impulse momentum method, because they're going to basically tell us the same thing, although we might have different uses for them. So clearly jump height tends to be more of interest to athletes because they understand what that number is and it is the motivation for them conducting the test. So we might use jump height to feedback to them, but focus perhaps more on power or impulse ourselves. Now, my exploratory metric currently at the time of recording in this bucket is net concentric impulse 100, or CON 100, as it's commonly referred to. And it's the creator of ForceDex, Dr. Dan Cohen, who is really advocating for this currently. So it is the impulse that is generated during the concentric phase of the jump in that first 100 milliseconds. So here we are standardizing that time to 100 milliseconds and basically looking at that force generation capacity in that instant first 100 milliseconds of the concentric phase. So really, it's isolating that initial explosive force production. And Dan has some interesting findings that he's seen with this metric. And I think we're going to see more and more discussion come out on this topic in the near future. With our outcome measures then, this might be something that is assessed from time to time. It might be something that's done 2, 3, 4 times a year at a time when athletes are fresh, which in many team sports is not very often, quite frankly. But you're trying to get an idea of when they are fresh and healthy, what is their physical capacity from a strength and power perspective in this familiar, simple demand of a counter-movement jump. Our next bucket then is monitoring. This is commonly conducted more frequently to try and assess where our athletes are at in terms of their fatigue and in terms of their response to training load. And with this purpose in mind, we're focused then more on strategy measures. Back in 2008, Stu Cormack demonstrated then that individuals can often maintain their jump height under fatigue by adjusting their movement patterns. Now, this might be conscious, but it also might be subconscious. The body just finds a way, and that's critical for the monitoring purpose. And why, although we would still look at our outcome measures, we want to look at how they achieve them, because those outcomes might not change, but the underlying strategy of how they achieved it may well do. So here I frequently look at contraction time to see how quickly their takeoff was. I'll also look at counter movement jump depth to see how deep they went in their jump. Now, again, there isn't one set rule for how the strategy will change with fatigue. Some athletes, when they're fatigued, might go deeper on their counter movement jump depth to try and get more leverage to propel themselves upwards. Conversely, though, many athletes might not go as deep if they've got muscle soreness. They're not as comfortable squatting as deep as they would normally. So it is about tracking these measures with your individual athletes and looking out for change. In this bucket, it's also common to look at one of the ratio metrics. Now, RSI mod, so reactive strength index, but modified from, say, a drop jump, in this case, to a counter movement jump, is very popular these days and gaining a lot of attention. And that is the jump height divided by the contraction time, so the time to take off. But actually, the flight time contraction time ratio came first. We have probably more research on that metric. I know Stu Cormack is a big proponent of it. And crucially, they both ultimately tell us exactly the same thing. So certainly no need to use both. And of course, anytime we're dealing with a ratio, as I always talk about, we also need to look at the underlying components, because if there has been a change in the ratio, we want to understand what's driving that. My current metric of interest in this particular bucket then is definitely eccentric peak velocity. And in my blog post, you can find a link to an article written by Dr. Morgan Williams and Dr. Dan Cohen, who I've already mentioned. So this can be really useful for a quality control check of whether a true counter movement jump was carried out by the individual. Eccentric peak velocity then gives us how quickly they were moving in that eccentric portion, so the bottom of the squat, when the body is having to decelerate itself to then turn around into the concentric phase and jump upwards. They have identified a threshold of minus 1.2 meters per second. If an individual's eccentric peak velocity is slower than that, which confusingly, because it's negative, means it would be a number closer to zero, so a number between 0 and minus 1.2, that suggests they haven't hit a sufficient peak velocity in the eccentric phase. And that could show that they did not go down with enough intent. And therefore, we're not probably using the stretch shortening cycle, and it's not really a counter movement jump. It's more likely to just kind of be a bit of a spring off. That, of course, might be a technique issue. It might be a familiarization issue. But if it's in an athlete that has done this consistently over time, it could also be a flag that perhaps they're struggling with fatigue. perhaps they either physically or mentally don't have that intent to jump as much as normal. And so again, it can work as a flag from both a data quality perspective, but then also potentially a flag for our monitoring approaches. The key really is to track this over time with your individual athletes, establish what is typical for them, and then analyze change from those norms to see when there might be a flag that something is going on with their fatigue status. We will also use a counter movement jump frequently for our rehab and return to play process. In rehab, then, the jump outcome measures are still of relevance. We want to see how their physical capacities have probably diminished with their injury and track, hopefully, those improvements over time. We may also be interested in the strategy metrics to see either how that's changing as a result of fatigue, but also as a result of the injury. And then we probably think of asymmetry metrics. Now, I have a whole video diving into the complexity of asymmetries and the calculation conundrum associated with them, because there's lots of different ways that we can calculate them. With my analysis of asymmetry metrics, I tend to stick generally with the mean force asymmetry. Peak force is literally a moment in time, and that may or may not be representative of their whole movement over a phase. So I tend to look at concentric mean force asymmetry as well as eccentric mean force asymmetry. And as I talked about in a couple of videos I did about the counter movement jump curve, I'll always look at those asymmetry figures in line with actually manually looking at the force time curve to see how the left and right compares to each other visually during the jump as well. In terms of exploring further, I have a couple at the moment, because for a while now I've been looking at force at zero velocity asymmetry. So that's the point at which we change from that eccentric phase into the concentric phase, then, to see how they are offloading, how balanced their force distribution is at that point in the jump. But also now there's interesting research coming out, particularly in ACL reconstruction athletes, around P1 and P2 concentric impulse asymmetry. So the P1 and P2 measures break that concentric phase in half based on the time of that phase. So P1 represents that impulse created from what I just mentioned in terms of the point of zero velocity to the halfway mark. And then P2 is that halfway mark to the takeoff, and therefore is more related to the triple extension part of the jump. Rula Kotsifaki at Aspetar has done some interesting work, and I'm sure there's more to come, around potential significant differences in these phases in asymmetries in individuals who have suffered, potentially even returned from ACL injury. So let's take a look at this framework as a whole. Again, we have those three buckets of outcome, strategy, and asymmetry. And you can see that with profiling in the blue, we're focused on our outcome measures to profile the physical capacities of our athletes. With monitoring then in the red line, you can see that going to both outcome and strategy measures, because when we are monitoring the load response status for athletes, we want to not just capture their outcomes, but their potential change in movement strategies as well. And then finally, our rehab measures, in which we are tracking potentially outcome measures, strategy measures, but also then our asymmetry measures. Of course, I've oversimplified this. So that's not to say that when you're profiling your athletes, you don't look at asymmetries, and you don't necessarily have to limit your approach to just these metrics. But as I said, this is probably the question I get most frequently. So I wanted to challenge myself to try and come up with what my framework would be as a starting point for individuals trying to get started with analyzing counter movement jump data. So that's just my approach. And I would love to hear from you in the comments if you feel strongly about a metric that should be added, or perhaps as well one that should be removed. Thank you to VALD for sponsoring this video and all the videos in our athlete testing series. Make sure you like and subscribe so you don't miss out on another Sports Science Insights video coming very soon.